Sometimes you can visit the same location 100 times over a period of 30 years without getting the perfect conditions. Other times, you're just damn lucky.
This is just absolutely glorious. That was crazy, but so worth it.
Before I tell the story about a morning in landscape photography heaven, we will visit a small and very nice waterfall in Yorkshire Dales. Scaleber Force Waterfall is located in a small wooded gorge close to Settle. Along the road there's room for parking and the waterfall is easy to find following the small trail for a couple of minutes from where you cross the stone wall. The trail divides into two, one which leads to the upper parts and one leading to the lower. Scaleber Force Waterfall is divided into several cascades and you need to follow the small trail to advance from one level to the other. We started at the bottom and worked our way up. The challenge was to get the entire waterfall within the frame without making the photo too confusing. That turned out to be a fair big challenge. I really like those wide angles where it feels the water is on its way out of the photo. Sort of a 3D effect where it feels the viewer is actually standing in the water. So how to create this effect? One way is to shoot with a wide-angle lens close to the foreground, creating a strong depth in the photo. Now shooting wide-angle, the foreground becomes very big, while the background becomes relatively small compared to the foreground. Even a very big background, such as a mountain, can become minuscule compared to a flower in the foreground if you're photographing with a broad focal length. Or a big waterfall in the background becomes small compared to a small stream in the foreground. So what you're doing is basically creating a strong depth, but with the risk of sacrificing the sense of scale. This effect is obviously something all photographers need to be aware of, and knowing how to use it in your composition greatly affects your storytelling. I'll make a video in the future going into details on composition. After having played around with some long exposures in the lower section, we tried out a few compositions at the upper section. Obviously, it can be slippery on the big stones, so be careful and bring some Wellingtons to move around more freely. The area is pretty tight and narrow, so a wide-angle lens is probably your best bet. If you do landscape photography for a longer period, you'll from time to time experience some really unique and unforgettable moments. I've already been lucky to have quite a few of those. One of the truly unique ones was the last morning I had in Great Britain, where we visited Chrome Hill in the Peak District.
So it is early morning and we had the most beautiful sunset yesterday. Sadly, we were in the car, so I was like annoyed by that. But I knew that there would probably be mist this morning, and rightly there is. So we probably parked a completely wrong place, but hopefully we will find our way.
You park at the bottom of the hill and follow the trail. Be sure to arrive via the road to the east, since the one from the west can be flooded or closed.
So according to this one photographer we have down here, there he is. This is quite a popular spot, so maybe that's why I found it on Google and Instagram. But right now there's too much mist, oh fuck, so we're going up a bit higher on the hill to see if I can get some kind of viewpoint from Chrome Hill where we are standing. onto a hill which is supposed to be here in the background, called Parkhouse Hill.
Now the amount of fog was actually too much of the good, so I put up the drone to see if I could get above the fog, knowing it would probably look pretty cool. The view I got was spectacular. After a little time, the top of Chrome Hill appeared out of the fog and we decided to go to the top of the hill.
The fog doesn't really want to clear up for now, but there's some beautiful opportunities for some tele zoom shots. So I will get that one out and start focus on all the details which starts popping up in the mist. It looks so beautiful. Like, we don't have something like this in Denmark. Well, maybe a few places we can get it, but this is just... I'm having goosebumps. It's so beautiful here. And I met this great bunch of photographers down here. Got beautiful pictures with them as a foreground. Beautiful.
Even though I got this spectacular drone footage, being on the ground photographing came with some challenges. Admittedly, there were actually way too much fog for photographing the surrounding area. The small details kept being covered and out of sight. I did, however, put the second battery into the drone and went for another fly. While flying around and moving up and down Chrome Hill, I noticed a fog bow forming along the edge. I of course had to take advantage of that situation and place Sophie at the right location along the side of the hill, which offers some nice small cliff outcrops where you can place either yourself or a model.
So far we have everything here. Just photographed a mist bow and I managed to place Sophie inside it. It looks absolutely spectacular. And right now we're still on Chrome Hill and waiting for Parkhouse Hill to come out of the mist. It's around here. So I placed Sophie in the foreground as to create some depth and some scale and a bit of like storytelling and epicness. And the cameras are ready to photograph as soon as Parkhouse Hill comes out. We are far out of the golden hour, sadly. So the light, or the color of the light, is not orange, not morning light. It's more like just white. But beside that, it's just a waiting game right now.
It did turn out to be one long waiting game, but suddenly, within a few minutes, the fog started to lift. When I got what I wanted from the top of the hill, I ran down to get the perspective I initially wanted at the big tree, along with another perspective along the ridge leading the eye to Parkhouse Hill. Even though Parkhouse Hill is a fairly small hill compared to Chrome Hill, when you make this kind of perspective, it really shows how big nature is. When it comes to lenses, you'd probably need anything from 16 to 200 millimeters, and also a drone if you get the amount of fog that we did. Jason with his project 73 and 73 was among the group of photographers we met on Chrome Hill. Be sure to check out the video with him and Thomas Heaton in the upper right corner. That is a very sad story, but also a good video with a good message. As I said, Chrome Hill was the last place we visited in Great Britain, but it is not the end of this video series. Far from it, it just made sense putting it in here as we work our way north. That morning on Chrome Hill was the absolutely best way to end our journey through Britain. Again, thank you so much for watching. The reception of and reaction to my last video has been absolutely amazing. I cannot express my gratitude towards all those super nice comments enough, but a huge, huge thank you to you all. It was actually at least a handful of you expressing it was the best vlog you've ever seen on YouTube. That means a lot, since I do follow most of the other vloggers in this field, and even though there is quite a lot of quantity out there, there is also a huge amount of high quality entertaining and educational videos. I would as always highly appreciate a like and a comment. It does show the YouTube algorithm the video is worth spreading on YouTube and showing to others. I'd also invite you to check out all the links below. There's a lot of information in regard to my gear with affiliate links, 20% off on a new homepage at SmugMug, which I'm about to renew for the fourth year. I'm very satisfied with it. Last but not least, there's also a link to my print shop on Society 6. Buying a print is by far and large the best and easiest way to support whichever photographer you like, since most of us are trying to live off of our art. In the next episode, we'll visit the largest national park of England, Lake District.